So back in the electrical workshop, I'm back with Marcus. So what are we up to today, Marcus?
So today, guys, we're going to be looking at fault finding on that dreaded ring final set.
Okay, so we've gone systematically through our dead test, another continuity in the CPC of the circuit. So we've got to the ring final circuit.
Yeah.
And which test is that in our sequence?
So that's test number two.
Okay, and where are you finding the issue?
So we find it on stage one of our continuity of our ring final circuit, which is our end-to-end test between line, neutral and CPC.
Okay, and which one have you got an issue with?
So our line CPC values were fine, okay, and what we would expect with the calculations we produced. But it was our neutrals that we had no reading, so we had an open circuit on our end-to-end of our neutral.
Okay, often at assess pieces for EAL and sitting guild, you have to identify the fault.
Yes.
Yeah, agree with that? Yeah. So it's probably a case of that might be it. You might say to your instructor, I've had an open circuit on my neutrals, I've got no continuity during stage one of the ring final circuit test, and that might be enough for them to tick that section.
They might then switch the fault out of circuit, so you can carry on testing as normal.
Okay, that's good. But we're going to go on, we're going to see the fault, so we'll show you that we've got an open-ended circuit on the neutral, and then we're going to try and systematically find where it is.
Yeah, we are, yeah. Look at the process to actually locating the fault in the circuit itself, not just at the consumer unit.
Okay, so we'll bring the camera a little bit closer so you can see what we're up to, and we'll see if we can identify the socket outlet that has caused us the issue. Okay, then Marcus, can you show us the test that you're going to perform and hopefully this neutral issue that you suggested in the start of the video for me, please?
Yeah, definitely, Gaz. So we're going to do stage one of our continuity of our ring final circuit. Now that is our end-to-end values between line conductors, neutral conductors and CPC conductors. Now I'm going to measure between my end-to-end for my line conductors, remembering this is my little R1 reading, and I get a reading of 1.01 ohms. I'm going to go on to my CPCs next, because this is twin and CPC cable, so we would expect this to be 1.67 times greater than the reading we got from our end-to-end for our line conductor.
So if the maths is right, this should be about 1.67. Wow.
Pretty bang on. I'm then going to do the end-to-end of my neutral conductors, remembering that I should get a very similar result within 0.05 plus or minus of my line conductor, because we have the same size cross-sectional area and we have the same length of conductor in circuit. And when I go on to my end-to-ends, you will see that I actually have no reading there, so I have an open circuit.
Can you elaborate on what you mean by open circuit on the neutral?
Yeah, so the open circuit being where the cable was broken somewhere in the circuit, so it might have come out the back of a socket outlet. It might be broken in a wall where someone's damaged the cable.
Okay, thank you. Okay then, keyboard warriors, this is a training rig, and yes, it looks a complete spiral mess in here. These cables come in, they go out, they go in, they come out 5 days a week. So, okay, I apologise for that in advance. With that in mind, Marcus, I can see one set here from the ring final circuit on its own. I can see the CPC. And you've connected together the line and neutral. What's your thinking behind that?
So what we were talking about earlier about splitting into two radials, that's what we've now done. We've identified both legs, split them apart, and we're doing continuity between our line and neutral. Remember, we're not actually necessarily worried about the values at the minute. We're just using it as a means of identifying where the break in the circuit is. So we've linked one leg together for a line and neutral and left this one disconnected for the time being.
So then we're going to go round with our plug-in tester. We've got in the top of the, is that a 1730?
It is.
Oh, you've got all the big stuff out. And we've got in the top here, we've got the conductors being the red and blue conductors in there, and you're going to measure at the socket outlets. If I get to a socket outlet that has no neutral in it, will I receive a reading?
No, you won't.
So we're trying to hunt down the missing reading?
We are, for the time being, yes.
Okay, let's pull back and have a look at that. Okay then, so you've shrunk Marcus, which is quite funny on camera. What are you going to do for me now?
So what we're going to do now is, now we've linked them in the board, line and neutral, we're going to systematically work our way around the circuit.
Okay.
So all I'm going to do is plug in, and I'm going to check my tester to see if I've got continuity between line and neutral.
Okay.
And I have. Now, a good thing about the radial is we can start to work out how maybe the circuit's been wired through testing.
Okay.
Because as we go round, we know that we've added resistance into the circuit, so the resistance should increase the further we're getting away.
Okay, so that's considerably further away than socket number one.
Yeah.
There's no need to do both sides. I like that. You don't bother doing both sides. No, this is just a hunting fault
thing. It is, yeah. So as you can see, now I've got a good idea now that this is being wired this way.
Okay.
Because it's going increasing in resistance.
Oh, yeah.
And again, it's increasing.
Okay.
No reading. And again, I'm just going to check this one. And again, no reading. So what I'm going to do now is I have a good idea that potentially these two are where one of our problems is. Okay. Now I could whip the fronts off and just check them too, because I don't have many sockets on. However, what I'm going to do is I'm going to link the other leg, between line and neutral in the consumer unit.
Yeah.
And disconnect the leg we've already got connected. And then when I test up one of these two, I should actually get a reading at one, I'm hoping. And that would give me a reference point as to between two places where the fault is occurring.
Oh, that's really good. So if this was a really big ring final circuit, there might have been 7-8 sockets now there. We're getting nothing.
Yeah.
We're going to chase the fault the other way down the other leg. I like it. Very good. So let's go back to the consumer unit and connect up. So back inside the consumer unit, I can see you've disconnected the connector block that was on this one here between line and neutral. Yeah. CPC still disconnected. We come over here, the CPC of this leg is disconnected. The line and neutral are connected together. And you're going to do what next?
So I'm going to work my way back around the circuit for the sockets that I didn't have a reading.
Okay, so we'll go back and we've got two sockets to test. And hopefully you're going to magically identify the one with the fault in?
Yeah.
Okay then, magic Marcus, find me that fault.
So now I've linked the other line of neutral from the other leg in the consumer unit. I'm now going to plug into my socket outlets that I didn't get a reading from before. So I'm going to go to this one first. And as you can see, I've got continuity between line and neutral. And again, this socket, I do not have continuity. Now, what that tells me is because I had continuity here and I have continuity here, my break is actually in between these two socket outlets. So just from testing without having to take all the front covers off, we've actually located between two reference points where that fault lies in the circuit. Now, that could be in a wall, it could be a joint box in the floor, it could be the back of the socket outlet. I'm not going to go and start ripping up floorboards before I've checked this socket outlet because this is my point of worry at the minute.
So let's take the front off and see if Magic Marcus has found the fault.
So I'm just going to whip the front off of the socket outlet that I believe could have the problem in. Again, at this point, I don't know the problem is in this socket outlet.
Just from my point of view, I hope it ain't buried in that wall because we've got to take the rig off the wall.
Yeah. And again, I can already see as I'm unscrewing this and it's levering out that my neutrals have actually popped out of the socket outlet.
All right, okay, so yeah, what a great way to find the fault. We know there's other methods of finding faults similar to this, and when one neutral is connected and one isn't. For us, this is at the level we're at with our level 3 learners in order to do fault finding. That was very well explained. Thank you, Marcus. So that was fascinating, Marcus. Can you explain why it's so important in a college environment we start to master testing and fault finding?
Again, guys, our apprentices, at the end of their 5357 or 2357 testing unit, they have an endpoint assessment. Yeah. They also have their AM2 or their AM2S when you're doing your 2391. All of these have a fault finding element to them.
And we've got it in controlled conditions.
We have, yeah.
In the real world, would we suggest there's other ways of doing this?
Of course there is. There's always another way to do it. You know, I'm not suggesting that we couldn't do it testing live and different other ways, but for our apprentices, they're not going to have the opportunity to do that in their endpoint assessment. So we show them the way to find them through dead testing only.
Be careful in the comments is what we're really saying. There is other ways of carrying this out. This is a controlled environment within a college.
And by all means, share them with us. You know, everyone has different experiences and no fault is the same.
No.
So
that's good. Shall we end it?
Yeah, I think we should.
Okay. Yeah. So we hope this video has been some help.